Hello. I don't know how I can follow that exotic start to the film with that all that music and those pictures of remarkable sights in Egypt, but you're just going to have to live with me talking to you here from Lincolnshire, rather than the sands of Egypt, which I would so much rather be in to be discussing this, and under the blazing sun, impossible these days for reasons we all know about. I'm recording this in the summer of, late summer of 2021. You will have gathered from the beginning of this film that it's about a pharaoh called Horemheb, someone you may never have heard of. And if you have heard of him, you may not know very much about him. Horemheb appears in lots of Egyptian histories, but often really rather briefly. Now, he's come up for me because, as you will be well aware from some of the films that I've posted on this channel, I'm writing a book about Egyptian history, and specifically the 18th Dynasty. It's called The Climax of Egypt. The 18th Dynasty sits right in the middle of Egyptian history, roughly equidistance between the time of the pyramids and the Ptolemaic pharaohs. Those are the line of pharaohs established by one of Alexander the Great's generals that ruled Egypt in its last few centuries and ended with Cleopatra the VII, who was, of course, toppled from her throne by the man who became Augustus Caesar, the first emperor of Rome, and ended Egypt's independence. Now, this was an extraordinarily important point in Egyptian history, that this couple of hundred years or more of the 18th dynasty, when Egypt reached its maximum wealth and power under a remarkable line of kings. And Horemheb is the last king of the 18th dynasty, except that he was not a blood member of it. He's not a blood member of the dynasty he establishes, the 19th dynasty. But he is in many ways the most fascinating of all the kings of the period. He's a remarkable man for having come from absolutely nowhere, risen to considerable heights as a warrior, and then becomes king. And that alone is a remarkable fact. The 18th dynasty had lasted well over 200 years by the time he became king, or thereabouts at any rate. It started with Ahmose the First, an Egyptian who expelled the Hyksos Asiatics, who had occupied northern Egypt in the Delta area with their headquarters at Avaris, their capital city. And Ahmose reunifies the country, makes Egypt one again, and is succeeded by Amenhotep I, who does not have a son of his own, and is succeeded by Thutmose I, or Thutmosis I. The name is spelt various different ways. Where Thutmosis I came from, we're not quite sure, but he was probably a member of the extended royal family. Now, he is succeeded by his son, Thutmose II, who is married to his half-sister, Hatshepsut, the famous queen who declared herself king because her half-brother, Thutmose II, predeceased her. He had had a son by a lesser wife called Thutmose III, who was going to become king later on, but he's too young to rule, but he becomes effectively a co-regent of his half-aunt Hatshepsut, who rules as king, with him nominally alongside her. She, of course, eventually dies. Thutmose III becomes an extraordinarily successful warrior king, and really takes Egypt to the apogee of its power and wealth in the 18th dynasty. And this is a fascinating period because it is a totally authoritarian regime based on some very powerful religious ideology, the promise of stability, the protection against order. And this is key to Horemheb, as we'll see in just a second, because the entire Bronze Age state, a structure of Egypt, is built around the person of the king, the identity of the king as a living god, tied up very much with the pantheon of Egyptian gods above all of this. And it's also fascinating to see how the identity of individual kings, while that exists, it's also partially submerged beneath a wider identity of the king as a kind of generic ruler. So in that sense, there's a very elastic notion of identity and achievement. So these kings are constantly usurping the monuments of their predecessors, blurring themselves into their predecessors and into the future. So it is, if you will, like a continuous series of a king, even if the kingship has a series of individual manifestations. Thutmose III is followed by his warrior son, Amenhotep II, a successful king, succeeded by his son, Thutmose IV, who dies relatively young and has benefited really from the remarkable success of the dynasty to that date. He doesn't really have to fight wars, and Egypt really is at an amazing state in its history. Magnificent achievements, technical achievements, magnificent artistic creation, but also built entirely on the oppression of labourers, which included Egyptians as well as prisoners of war, very young population, large numbers of children and very young adults dying prematurely with broken bodies to support this edifice. Now, I talk about that in some of the other lectures on this channel, so I don't need to go into that detail now. But you have to remember that is the other side to all the glory. It's far too easy to be beguiled by the beauty of Egypt and overlook this side to it. Now, Thutmose IV is succeeded by his son Amenhotep III. Amenhotep III is a king who reigns for several decades, one of many kings who had actually succeeded really as children or as very young adults at the most. And that's something often overlooked about the pharaohs of the 18th dynasty, just how young they were when they came to the throne. And it's quite a comment on the system that it was able to accommodate such young kings and remain stable. In the medieval period, the accession of a young king was a very dangerous feature for the kingship in a medieval country. So easy for a court faction to topple him or to build up rival claims. Egyptians managed to a large extent to avoid that. Now, Amenhotep III is also the subject of a specific lecture on this talk, so I'm not going to go into that now, how he ruled and the power and the wealth that existed then. But he's succeeded by his son Akhenaten, who is the celebrated religious heretic who throws out all the existing Egyptian gods, or virtually all of them, and builds everything around the Aten sun god disk, with himself as the sole intermediary between the Aten and the Egyptian people. Now, Akhenaten dies probably within 2 decades of his accession, and I'm not going to go into the details of what happens immediately afterwards. That's phenomenally complicated. What we do know is that during Akhenaten's reign, Horemheb was already a soldier of some sort, and the reason we know that is that under Tutankhamun, who was probably Akhenaten's son, probably by a lesser wife. His parentage is uncertain, but he was undoubtedly a member of the royal family. That is no doubt at all. But during his reign, Horemheb was a very senior general, fighting wars on Tutankhamun's behalf. Now, Tutankhamun dies as a young man, very young man, perhaps 18, 19, 20 years old at most, unexpectedly. He was married to Akhenaten's daughter, Ankhesen Amun, and they have had no children, apart from the 2 miscarried fetuses, which were found in his tomb. He is succeeded by an elderly official called Ay. Now, Ay's origins are unknown also, but there's been a very sensible theory that he may be connected with Tutankhamun's grandmother's family. His grandmother was Ti, the wife of Amenhotep III, but the evidence is only circumstantial. There is nothing to explain that at all. All we can say is that Ay occupied a number of titles and positions which had previously been held by Ti's father, a man called Yua. That is all discussed in other talks on this channel. Ay only lasts 3 or 4 years. I've just called him elderly, incidentally. He was probably in his 60s, which means he's about the same age as I am. And I don't think of myself as being elderly. But in those days, 60 was very elderly in Egypt. It was possible to live longer. It's always been possible to live to an advanced age. It's just that fewer people had the opportunity to do so in those days. I seems to have died after only 3 or 4 years, at the most. And then he was succeeded by Horemheb. And that alone is an extraordinary fact, because Horemheb has no dynastic connection whatsoever to any of the previous kings in the 18th dynasty. Let's be in no doubt. Horemheb cannot have grown up expecting to have become king. There are no circumstances in which he could legitimately have expected to become king. All that we know about him is that he seems to have come from a town called Heracleopolis, which is near the Fayum oasis in the western desert, because when he became king, he claimed that Horus, lord of Het-Nezu, the name of that city, had plucked him from obscurity and chosen him to become king. Horemheb is characteristically oblique about this. While he claims to have been chosen by Amun, he never claims to have been the son of a woman impregnated by Amun, by a woman, I mean a queen, and the normal myth was that Amun, in the manner of the king, impregnates the queen, and the son, therefore, that the next pharaoh is therefore, by definition, the son of Amun. Now, Horemheb never quite goes that far, yet during Tutankhamun's reign, he had been something that is usually translated as a hereditary prince, but also means a senior noble. Now, that title could mean that he was designated to be the heir to the throne. That's possible. But if actually, there are a number of instances where it has no such meaning. So it's a typically ambiguous term. If you read one Egyptology book, you'll be told, oh, it marked him out as the heir. But actually, if you look the words up, if you understand the number of different related meanings it had, there's nothing explicit about that at all. Some people have linked him to Pa'atenheb, who was a very senior military officer during Akhenaten's reign. It's a similar name. Horemheb's name means horse in festival. Pa'atenheb means Aten in festival. But in fact, there's absolutely nothing to tie the two men together, nothing whatsoever. Horemheb is not known during Akhenaten's reign at all. There is the question of his wife, at least the wife who becomes his queen, who was called Mutnojmet. Now, it was long believed that Nefertiti's sister was a woman called Mutnojmet, but that appears to have been a misreading of the hieroglyphs. And I can assure you, actually, if you go and look at the hieroglyphs, that does seem to be the case. Nefertiti's sister is a woman called Mutbenret. It's a very similar meaning. And even so, even if it was the same name, which it doesn't appear to be, just because someone's got the same name doesn't necessarily mean that it's the same person. And you often get this in Egyptology, and I think it's a sort of scrabbling around to find order in the chaos of the record. It would have been quite convenient for Horemheb to have married Nefertiti's sister, Nefertiti being the queen of Akhenaten, because it would have given him a link into the family. But I must stress that there is nothing to prove that whatsoever, and there's certainly it's in that sense an unsustainable theory. All we know then about Horemheb is that he was a man of obscure origins who came from the Fayum area, who had risen up through the army, and we also know from some of his personal monuments, his inscriptions, his statues, he was literate, he was a scribe, he was very keen to promote the idea that he was highly educated. And this is very important because being literate and highly educated already made him significantly different from some of the kings during the dynasty. We do, for example, know that Thutmose III was trained as a priest and was literate, but we don't know about that, about all of them at all. And therefore, Horemheb already sticks out as quite a remarkable individual, because by the time that Tutankhamun was dead, and then Ay was dead a few years later, Horemheb is so well established and far on in his career, he's in a completely different class of individual from somebody becoming king at the age of 9 or 10, as Tutankhamun did, or many of his predecessors before the age of 20 at the outside. This is an experienced, able man who knows Egypt, who knows the army, he knows Egypt's neighbours because he's been fighting there. This is a man of considerable achievement and aplomb. This is someone who is potentially, I suppose you could say, quite a threatening individual to the crown, except that there's no indication that Horemheb ever put himself out in that way before. And during the reign of Ay, who succeeded Tutankhamun, Horemheb is completely invisible. Probably because he's on campaign, but it's also clear that he made no effort to become king at the end of Tutankhamun's reign, even if he had been designated heir. Now, one possibility is that Ay stole a march on him. Because Horemheb was away, there was Ay's chance to get himself on the throne, even at his advanced age. And Ay had a son or a grandson called Nacht, which means strength, who may have been the designated heir, and therefore I would have established his own line. All we know is that Nak disappeared and I did not live very long. So maybe that was the opportunity that Horemheb was waiting for. Now, I've already mentioned that Horemheb works quite quickly to establish his own ideology of destiny. It's a very important trope in Egyptian history, and all the pharaohs did this, which was to establish the notion of how they were predestined to become king. Hatshepsut, the queen who became king, had gone to enormous efforts to establish her own myth of destiny, partly to compensate for the fact that as a woman she would not normally have expected to become king. The Egyptians wouldn't have expected her to become king either. So Horemheb has a bit of a job on his hands, but he is very keen to have statues made that show him to be, for example, one alongside Atum, the creator god, the inscriptions that show that he was chosen by Amun. But, as I said before, he doesn't quite go as far as mentioning that he is a member of the dynasty descended by blood, apart from one single instance where he does have a reference back to one of the Thutmose kings, in which he says, father of my fathers. Now, that only happens once, and it's just one very rare instance where he does seem to allude to a claim of blood kinship, but my suspicion is that that's just part of the pro forma, part of this very elastic ability to blur identity and connection. So that puts Horemheb on the throne, not immature, not inexperienced. For the first time almost in the 18th dynasty, Egypt has a king who has the experience and intelligence to do the job in a completely different way. I think most kings define themselves and their reigns really very quickly. It becomes obvious fairly fast what sort of man they are, what sort of ruler they are. And the same equally applies to queens, where they are ruling in their own right, just as Hatshepsut had done. Horemheb had really quite a task on his hand. Let's just be clear about the context. Akhenaten had died perhaps 14 or 15 years before. That had been the end of his religious revolution. Now, under Tutankhamun and Ay, there is already the process underway of undoing that time, setting things back to the way they had been. But Horemheb seems to be very keen to obliterate the achievements of his immediate predecessors, and he wants to create a sense that it's him. He is the one who is restoring stability. He is the one who is going to put Egypt back the way it had been before. Now, there's a sort of paradox there, because in one sense he has to acknowledge the fact there's been a crisis, while at the same time, historically, what we find in the records is that he is doing everything possible to create a narrative in which Akhenaten, Tutankhamun and Ay had never existed. And that goes down in Egypt's annals. And as you'll have seen at the beginning of this film, the official king lists just don't mention them. Horemheb is depicted as having succeeded Amenhotep III. Now, right from the word go, he has a coronation text. This is something that is written up very early in his reign. And he says on it, claims that the king, now he doesn't say who the king is. Rather conveniently, he avoids naming him, leaving one with the rather vague notion that it was probably Tutankhamun, but at the same time allows it officially to look as if it was Amenhotep III. So he says how the king had set him to be supreme chief of the land to steer the laws of the two regions, and that means the opposite banks of the Nile, as hereditary prince of this entire land. And he goes on to make sure that you're clear that he is unique in that capacity. Now, that's when he goes on to acknowledge that there was something he was trying to rectify. He refers to the fact that he'd been summoned before the king when the palace had fallen into a storm. Now, that's a colloquial phrase in Egyptian, and the word that is used refers to a major weather disaster, but of course that isn't actually what it means. It seems to be used as a metaphor for enragement or chaos, and the sort of sentence that you or I might use is to say just after a time when a tornado had ripped through the palace. And you can imagine what that means. It's a complete upheaval at the heart of power. So what Horemheb is doing is saying, right, total chaos, totally disastrous period, but I'm the one who was chosen, predestined to come and set everything in order. Now, you might be thinking at this moment, you've said earlier on in this film that he was a terrific ruler, and right at the beginning of the film I explained the Enlightened Despot, which you've seen at the title at the beginning of the film. Perhaps this man's just an egomaniac. Well, After a period of disorder, it's actually very important for rulers to create a sense of stability and command of the crisis. And goodness knows, don't we live in a time when governments across the world are trying to convince all of us that they are in charge of the crisis that currently is prevailing across the world? So he compares himself to Thoth, the god of knowledge and wisdom. And he makes a lot of how he has readjusted the land to the time of Re, back to the days of the proper sun god, Re. He's restoring the temples, and the words that he uses for restoration is one that also means to strengthen or to perpetuate. So within all of this, with all his abilities and his skills, and of course it's seamlessly obvious as to why he would have been chosen as the new king. So he's essentially doing this very important job, which is to restore normality and stability. And one of the ways that he does this is to start deleting any of the references to his immediate predecessors. Anything that they did towards restoring normality and stability is taken under his wing. His name is put on the monuments. So you end up with a sort of remarkable phenomenon of a very youthful-looking King Horemheb. It's actually Tutankhamun in the statues or reliefs, but with Horemheb's names. Now, what he's also doing is he's taking a lot of time and trouble to make sure that he's really in charge of the situation. And because he's a soldier, a very successful one, or so he claimed, he therefore has the support of the army, and he starts to put soldiers in key positions, including the Amun priesthood. Now, he is restoring the primacy of the god Amun and the temple at Karnak, this extraordinary politico-religious centre of Egyptian power, absolutely locked in with the state, that had been totally marginalised during the Akhenaten period. Horemheb puts that back together again, but he puts his own men there. He places his own people in it, people he knows he can rely on as supporters, so he's taking a lot of care there. He also, for example, takes Tutankhamun's own restoration stela, which is an inscription itemising Tutankhamun's claims to have restored temples and things. Horemheb just simply relabels it as having been his. Now, under Tutankhamun, the city of Akhetaten, Horizon of the Aten, which was Akhenaten's city to the north, was already being run down under Tutankhamun's reign, being given up, left to go back to the desert. And it seems almost inevitable at this stage that Horemheb carries on that process of dismantling and moving the stone and letting the city run down. At some point during this process, Ay's tomb in the Valley of the King, the Western Valley of the Kings, which had probably originally been designated for Tutankhamun, Ay's tomb is entered and totally desecrated. His sarcophagus smashed up, his memory obliterated. That might have happened to Tutankhamun's tomb if anybody had known where it was. But probably by this time already, Tutankhamun's tomb had been lost under flood debris in the middle of the valley. It had already been robbed twice, in fact, to a modest degree. Ay's tomb is totally smashed up. Tutankhamun can't be found, even if it was looked for, and that just simply doesn't happen. So Horemheb is making a number of important gestures. And nevertheless, he also is restoring things in other ways. He checks up on the other royal tombs, and there's an actual docket in his eighth regnal year, in which a team go and inspect, for example, the tomb of Thutmose the Fourth, where they go down and make sure that the tomb is in all order. It looks as if Horemheb is trying to preside over making sure that the legitimate pharaohs of the past, their tombs are properly protected. I must stress, we don't know who was responsible for smashing up Ay's tomb, but it was so aggressive, it does look like someone who was trying to cut Ay out of the record. And it's certainly true that virtually all Ay's monuments, many of which had been themselves usurped from Tutankhamun's, were taken over by Horemheb. Now, one of the other big jobs he sets about is that he completes the dismantling of Akhenaten's huge Djemparaten temple at Karnak. Now, the Djemparaten means the Aten, or of the Aten. Gem is a difficult word, which is often translated as the discovery of the Aten, but in fact it has other meanings, like the enabling of Aten or the use of Aten. But it was a huge, great complex just to the east of the sprawling existing Amun complex at Karnak. And Horemheb undoubtedly sees to the dismantling of it. Now, one of the great ironies about Akhenaten's temple is that he'd used things called talatats, which are little rectangular blocks of stone which had made for mass production, made it very simple for that temple to be built quickly during his religious revolution. This also made it very easy for Horemheb's men to take it to pieces and use all these common pieces like bricks as fillings and components of the building work that Horemheb now engages in at Karnak. So for it, he's certainly responsible for the second pylon at Karnak, which is filled with bits of the Aten temple, and the space behind it becomes the hypostyle hall built by 19th dynasty pharaohs. Horemheb may have planned that, but doesn't seem to have been responsible for it. He certainly created the space for it. He also builds the 10th pylon, or completes the 10th pylon, which I think had been begun by Amenhotep III, and he also builds the 9th pylon. And the talatat blocks are used as filling, and the great irony for Horemheb is if he was trying to get rid of Akhenaten, all he succeeded in doing was preserving many of those carved stones, which with the use of computer databases have now been, in many instances, restored into their original relief patterns, relief designs, showing us life under Akhenaten. Nevertheless, at the time, and this is what matters, Akhenaten's stuff was completely buried and concealed, while Horemheb is visibly expanding the Karnak complex. And this is another of the fascinating phenomena about the 18th dynasty kings, is that they are, because of the limitations of Egyptian architecture, one of the only ways they can aggrandize buildings is just to keep extending them. And Karnak is built on an east-west axis, and there's also a southerly route of pylons. And really what Horemheb has done is succeeded in just lengthening it in both those directions, leaving some quite impressive remains which are visible today. And that is all part of how Horemheb is, I suppose this part of the story is, Horemheb is really trying to undo and obliterate the work of his predecessors. And that includes obliterating everything Akhenaten had done, but also obliterating the attempts by Tutankhamun and Ay to obliterate Akhenaten's work. And the result is that it then all becomes subsumed under Horemheb's watch, and reinforcing the notion that actually he'd become king much earlier than he had done. And this can't have fooled anybody, because even at this stage, even in a population of people who don't live very long, there must have been plenty of people who knew perfectly well that Akhenaten and Tutankhamun and Ay had ruled. So he's not fooling anybody. And that's what takes away from the idea that this is somehow really aggressive. It is implicitly, but I think we have to understand that this Egyptian perception of power and royal identity is different from ours. And perhaps the only way I can easily compare that with is medieval coinage in England. These are all facing portraits of kings. They're not lifelike. The Edwards and Henrys, the numbers of the kings are virtually never mentioned. They just simply reinforce an ongoing image of kingship. And that is much like what is going on in Egypt. Yes, the names are explicit, although don't forget that most people couldn't read and write in Egypt. What they see are endless images of Pharaoh ruling. And what Horemheb effectively is doing is he's creating a trope about himself, but at the same time blurring himself within that whole narrative story of the 18th dynasty, where the Egyptians are ruled by a king who is constantly renewed, who dies as Horus, he dies, becomes Osiris, and his son, the Horus, succeeds him. And they're all the chosen of Aten, who is ultimately their progenitor. And that's where Horemheb is placing himself. So by pasting over his immediate predecessors, he is restoring that sense of eternity, something so fundamental to Egypt. But Horemheb had a much bigger task on his hands, and this is where he becomes really profoundly interesting in a way that I don't think many other Egyptian kings can ever be. But first of all, let's consider Horemheb the warrior. When Horemheb was a general, he built himself an elaborate tomb at Saqqara, which is the necropolis of the great administrative capital of Egypt at Memphis, which is fairly close to where Cairo is today, so much further north from Thebes and where Karnak was. This elaborate tomb, with its surface chapel, this tomb is covered in glorious reliefs, a number of which are dispersed into museums around the world today, but there are many still on site. This shows the conquering hero of Horemheb being celebrated with captives brought before the king and queen, Tutankhamun and Ankhesenamun at the time. And all the violence that goes with that, you can see the captives being beaten up by Horemheb's men. There he is in receipt of great gifts and everything else from the king, his rewards. But the hilarious side to this is that, of course, Horemheb had gone on to become king. And he hadn't died during that time. There he is, now he's a pharaoh. This tomb at Saqqara is not appropriate for his needs. He usurps it himself. So Tutankhamun in the tomb becomes Horemheb, which means we have this extraordinary existential paradox in which Horemheb is being rewarded and congratulated by himself. And he even goes to the extent of having his portrait modified with the addition of the ureus on his brow to show that he is now a king. And you can see that on a number of the reliefs from the tomb. Absolutely, again, just a totally fascinating idea of how the Egyptians were able to deal with identity and achievement in such a strangely contradictory way, a way that apparently made sense to them, but of course very difficult for us fully to fathom out. He has been congratulated by the king who wasn't him, but now the king is him, so the king, as him, congratulates himself. And the tomb was left like that. His wife, Nojmet, and possibly an earlier wife as well, were buried there. Certainly remains of a woman were found in there who may well have been his queen, Nojmet. So she's not destined for burial in down in the Valley of the Kings, or the Valley of the Queens, which had only really just come into existence at that stage. And there was not yet a tradition of queens having their own tombs in the Valley of the Queens, or even much in the Valley of the Kings. So it's not totally illogical that she would be buried somewhere else. The tomb, of course, shows Horemheb the great warrior. You might have expected that Horemheb would have therefore been a very sought to have become a warrior king during his reign. In fact, he doesn't. There's very little evidence to suggest that he ever did anything like that. There is a relief on the 10th pylon at Karnak that shows Asiatic captives during his reign being brought before gods. And it's there's also, however, I'd like to point out, under Ramesses II, and many decades later, there is a peace treaty with the Hittites, and that seems to suggest that it came at the end of a protracted period of tension and intermittent warfare. And indeed, Horemheb may well have been fighting Hittites during Ay's reign, which is why he wasn't on hand to become king at the end of Tutankhamun's reign. But really, there's just not much. There's a little bit more at the Gebel el-Silsila near Aswan, where there are some reliefs which seem to mention a war involving Nubia, but it's all a little bit vague. It's not clear at all. Actually, Horemheb seems to have had rather more important things to do. Quite apart from simply restoring stability and normality, Horemheb seems to have understood something fundamental about kingship. It's not all about aggrandizing yourself, making the royal family wealthy, wealthier. It's not all about building gigantic monuments of yourself. As far as I know, there are no gigantic statues of Horemheb. There are statues of Horemheb, but not the huge ones that had been increasingly common under the Thutmosid pharaohs, and particularly Amenhotep III. He has a lot of building work at Karnak, but it doesn't seem to be characterised by huge, great images of himself. What he does carve on the 10th pylon is his great edict, and this is all about reforms. Now, why I think this is fascinating is there was an English philosopher called Thomas Hobbes, 1588 to 1679. Now, Hobbes was, who wrote a book called The Great Leviathan, all about the state, about how government works. And in Hobbes's ideas, peoples accept the state in the person of the king, so long as he insulates them against disorder, instability and justice. That's the contract between the people and the ruler. Now, there are examples in the 18th dynasty of some of the kings behaving that way. Ahmose the First, for example, had dealt with the fallout of a terrible storm during his reign a couple of centuries before. Horemheb is different, though. He seems to articulate the principle, a deeper philosophy of the idea of the king. And in that sense, I think he anticipates thought about rule thousands of years before it became much more clearly defined in human culture. In the Bronze Age, it's all about the absolute authoritarian monarch. And Horemheb is that person. But he understands that he is beholden as king to play his part, to pay his side of the contract, to fulfil the expectations of the people in order to justify his position. What he talks about is Egypt that is handicapped by a significant number of problems. Now, he doesn't actually articulate a philosophy of kingship, but he is operating on those lines. He deals with a whole series of quite specific grievances which have been represented to him. Now, of course, it suits Horemheb to paint what had come before him as a period of disorder, of chaos, of unfairness, of injustice. That is going to help justify his position. So we can't be naive about that. Of course he is going to do that. Every politician today comes to power claiming that the previous administration has been lousy, defective, inadequate, and that he or she is now going to set those things right. So there is an element of that, but on the other hand, the grievances are so specific, they sound as if they've become embedded in Egyptian culture as a matter of precedent, and they seem to be symptomatic of the exploitation and corruption that had underwritten 18th dynasty power and wealth, and why this the royal family had become so so wealthy, so dominant. And it also reminds me of the so-called bastard feudalism of the English Middle Ages, when wealthy and powerful aristocrats could use their retainers to do exactly as they pleased, or even defy the crown. And that is certainly true of some of the regional officials in Egypt, some of the aristocrats. There's a lot of indication here of that. And Horemheb's edict is describing a country afflicted by violence and oppression. Now, it's hard to know exactly how much truth there is, but the circumstantial evidence of Akhenaten's reign is for a certain amount of dwindling of royal power. It is undoubtedly true that Akhenaten had cut himself off, isolated himself in Akhetaten, marked out by the boundary stela which surround that city, and in many ways just demarcated it as a kind of enclave. So it's not implausible that there was a lot of problems in Egypt. Horemheb's edict describes various criminal activities. He says that taxes were being taken by tax collectors for themselves. The punishments are itemized for this. The army is described as stealing cattle and hide from villagers, who they beat up for good measure. Horemheb decreed that any soldier who was caught doing that was going to be dealt with 100 blows, 5 wounds, and to have, for example, any animal hides that they'd taken seized back from him. Villagers had been subjected to vegetables being stolen from them by officials who told them that it was being done in the name of the king. As a classic corruption in a state is where officials or aristocrats say they are entitled to do this in the name of the king. Soldiers who were involved in ripping off these dues that were supposed to be sent to the royal harem or temples were told that they would have their noses cut off and they'd be sent to the fortress of Jaru, which is on the road into Canaan, a really bleak frontier outpost that no soldier would ever want to go to. Another very interesting side to this is the edict says that on the journey to and from Memphis for the Opet festival in Thebes, the staff of the queens and their harems, which really means a euphemism for their entourages and households, had become accustomed since Thutmose the third time, so that's way back, to making unreasonable demands on the local communities they passed. The people involved had simply used the pretext that they were imposing legitimately at the demands of the king. And the abuse is a classic manifestation of how poisonous an absolute monarchy can be in its effect on the wider population. And I have the sense that Horemheb knew that, that he realised, and remember, he was not a member of the family. This is somebody who's become king through force of circumstance and opportunity. A man with considerable abilities. The wit and intelligence to see that you undermine the power and authority of the crown if you abuse your prerogative. You discredit it. So Horemheb is trying to deal with that. He also deals with justice. Now, there was no structure of justice in Egypt in the sense that there was no independent judiciary. It's all done through the local judiciary panels called the Kenbets, who just seem to have been local worthies. And Kenbet itself is actually a very interesting word that somehow means sitting in a corner. And I think it must refer in some way to the furniture on which they sat when they heard cases. And the only equivalent I can think of that in our language is when we refer to a panel of judges as the bench. Something like that seems what it seems to mean. And so these are reorganised to reform them so that they are better able to deal with local grievances. So what he's painting a picture of, Horemheb that is an Egypt that's become wearily accustomed to a culture in which the king or whoever is acting on his authority had contemptuously treated the wider population. And you can see that at so many other points in history. You only need to think of, for example, Tsarist Russia, for example. And Horemheb seems to have understood that there was a better way to legitimate the office of the king. Just going around and taking stuff off people and saying you're the king and so there you're entitled to do so does not give you the authority to rule. Horemheb knew that the king had to be better than that. He had to reform it. The king had to be someone who protected you, not ripped you off. This doesn't mean that he is going to do away with the royal prerogative to take a certain amount of produce or output of the crown of the country. I mean, that's always necessary. That's what we do today with taxes. It's why we have public services. So he's being essentially completely pragmatic, and this is durable. I mean, he uses regional administrators. He splits it between the north and south. There's a vizier now in Memphis and Thebes. That's clever because he's dividing that authority. They act on his behalf, but by having two of them, therefore the power is split and they are both reporting to him. And he actually says to them, and these are his words, don't transgress, don't overstep the mark. How then shall those like you judge others when one of you is committing a crime against justice? And he also does the same thing with the army. He splits it under two commanders. And that means it's less likely that there would ever be a coup against royal authority. Horemheb knew Egypt very well and he understood it. And he's therefore familiar with Egypt's everyday ways. And I think this is one of the most important things about him. He reorganises the distribution of food from royal storehouses to officials. And that is a very clever thing to do, because what he is doing is by redistributing the wealth in a trickle-down way, he's diminishing the motivation these people might have for using their positions to rip people off corruptly. So it's essentially like effectively paying them better wages. Egypt doesn't have money in the way that we understand it, but it's an enlightened way of improving and reforming the structure. Now, it's obviously rhetorical, and there's a rhetorical element to this. It is absolutely easy to understand that Horemheb is bound to present this as being a good thing, that he is trying to present himself as a much better kind of king. And it's also true that he is, to a large extent, strengthening the crown. So you could say that that is playing into the hands of tradition. But he is also, perhaps, I think you can argue, an enlightened despot. He is a despotic ruler, but there is a level of enlightenment. So I think there's a reasonable balance to be seen here. And there I would perhaps compare him with Frederick the Great of Prussia, who ruled in the mid to late 18th century. Now, there was a man who used his power, but also introduced a number of reforms and benefits for the population in general. Horemheb also doesn't have an heir, so long as we know. And this, in a sense, ring fences him, if you like. He's a sort of standalone pharaoh, and it gives him a huge advantage. It means he can therefore appoint the best man for the job. And he looks around and he picks on a man called Paramesu. And this man has a son called Seti, and there is also a grandson, Ramesses. And this is the man. He's a general. He's from Horemheb's generation. This is a man that Horemheb knows he can trust, will not live long, but already has a son and grandson in place. So therefore, Horemheb is adding to his reforms by presenting Egypt with a dynastic structure that will carry on Egypt well into the future. This is not something that had happened before in the 18th dynasty quite so clearly. This is an experienced man who's ruling Egypt finding another experienced man who can rule as a caretaker for a few years, who comes with a ready-made heir, and if you like, a spare, coming after that. So that's actually very important in a country like Egypt. Ramesses II will become one of the longest living pharaohs right in the 19th dynasty, and it all goes back to Horemheb. Now, Ramesses II had his own faults, and that's another story altogether. But collectively, the picture one gains with Horemheb is a man who was not only obliterating the issues of his immediate predecessors, but was going beyond the call of duty, certainly in Egyptian royal tradition, by reforming things. He had a long way to go in the sense that he did not have some great academic definition of kingship. But he knew that there were lots of problems which he sought to put right. Yes, it benefited him. Yes, it benefited royal power. But it also benefited people in Egypt. And that's where you see the essential contract. And that's what makes Horemheb so different from his predecessors. Why he's such an interesting individual. I've already mentioned that Horemheb did not have an heir, at least so far as we know. We don't even know how long he reigned. There is no reference to his death in any of the existing records. He built a brand new tomb for himself in the Valley of the Kings, known today as KV 57. It's a large and elaborate tomb, architecturally quite sophisticated. It wasn't finished, but he'd obviously been buried in it. There were wine jars in it when it was found. Fragments of wine jars were found, and some of them had references to his 13th and 14th regnal years. So that means he'd lived at least that long. But there is a really strange reference to a 59th regnal year from the wall of a scribe's tomb at Saqqara. Now, the only way that that can make sense is if the 31-odd years of Akhenaten, Tutankhamun and Ay had been added into Horemheb's reign, which would mean that Horemheb reigned for about 28 years. Now, that's just a best guess. It is impossible to say exactly what happened. And there's no good looking at other records. For example, the Manetho, the priest who wrote in Greek hundreds and hundreds of years later, who provided his record of the dynastic system, because it's extremely confused at this stage, and it really doesn't make sense, apart from the fact that there is a king he calls Horus, with a reign of 36 years and 5 months. But, you know, it's simply impossible to say. The tomb itself was found in 1908 by a man called Theodore Davis and his team, and it was an extraordinary story. The 18th dynasty's last blast of sepulchral grammar had been wrecked by tomb robbers, followed by debris that had tumbled down through the corridors and rooms over the centuries that followed. Theodore Davis's assistant, Edward Ayrton, had to climb over the fill to find an inscription that confirmed it was Horemheb's tomb. And this band of excited explorers struggled down through the stifling heat, crammed between the stones and the sand and the ceiling. Along the way, they found that the well chamber had been equipped with a painted false wall to fool tomb robbers. The plan failed, and the wall had clearly been breached as soon as the robbers, almost certainly armed with some advance information and the necessary equipment, reached it. Let's just have a look at some of the pictures that were taken in the tomb. They made their way down another 180 feet to the burial chamber, fascinated by the shattered grave goods lying all around in the state of incomplete decoration, ranging from finished painted reliefs and to the sketch schemes nearby on other walls that had not yet been executed or painted. There was a unique depiction of the Book of Gates. They were, and the furthest part of the burial chamber, they were confronted with Horemheb's sarcophagus and a few bones left in it. If they were his, I don't know what's happened to them. The remains of two women on the floor and those of a man in the further chambers, and those were all intrusive later burials. And they were greeted in the final last chamber by a unique painted figure of Osiris in a single panel. The paintings in Horemheb's tomb showed this low-born man absorbed into the canonical tradition of a king's funeral. In the room leading into the hall in the burial chamber, he was shown being greeted by Anubis, god of the necropolis, with Isis, Horus, Hathor and Osiris. It was a clear expression of the restoration of order, though there was some modification of detail. The quality was high, but despite the residual traces of the animated realism pioneered at Akhenaten's city some years before, the purpose was clearly to revive and re-establish older traditions. The events of recent years had had some impact on the availability of necessary skills, which took some years to mature, so they're still finding their way with this, with trying to get back to the old artistic tradition. Despite everything that he had done to restore Egypt to order and stability, Horemheb was treated the same way as almost all his predecessors. His tomb was inspected in year 4 and 6 of the so-called Renaissance period during the reign of Ramesses XI, when the first major bout of official removals and reburials of kings was undertaken while despoiling those bodies and tombs. The two graffiti that were found correspond in that refer to those inspections correspond in content with more specific records of body removal at other royal tombs. If Horemheb's body was taken out at that time and buried in one of the caches of royal mummies, it has not survived. Without Horemheb's body, it's impossible to estimate his age at death. Perhaps that's some small consolation to him. Instead of the grisly bandaged remains of so many other 18th dynasty kings, Horemheb lives on in his magnificent Saqqara tomb reliefs made when he was in his prime. The stunning high-quality painted sculptures and reliefs that have been completed in his Theban tomb, and some of the outstanding statuary from his pre-royal career and when he was king. Horemheb's legacy was to bring the 18th dynasty to an end without allowing Egypt to descend into the civil war of instability of a disputed succession. Securing the future was no mean achievement, given the epic events of recent decades. For a brief time, the weaknesses of Egypt's absolute monarchy were tempered by the luxury of being ruled by a capable king, who had no choice but to select his successor from the best men available. It would be no exaggeration to say that Horemheb rescued Egypt from the fallout of the late 18th dynasty, at least for the moment. There is just one tiny little anecdote left about Horemheb. Egypt had the most extraordinary calendar system. It had a civil calendar that lasted 365 days. That was made up of 12 months of 30 days plus 5 intercalary days, there's your 365. But we all know the year is 365 and a quarter days. So when this kicked off in 2781 BC, the civil calendar started to jump ahead by a quarter of a day every year, immediately. And this means that after 4 years, it was a day ahead. And it took an entire 1360 years for the system to come back in alignment. And the time it did that was actually around the beginning of Horemheb's reign. And they would have known that. This is the first time that the civil calendar was back in alignment with the sun. It all started on, the calendar was supposed to start on July the 19th, which was when Sirius, the star, rises at the same time as the sun in the morning. That had been the point in 2781 BC when it started. And it came back around the time that Horemheb was king. And it was not to come around again until the reign of Antoninus Pius, a Roman emperor who by then ruled Egypt in around 138 to 139 AD. What this means is that Horemheb's reign coincided with the time that the Egyptians understood when the heavens were back in order. So the symbolism of that can't possibly have been missed, assuming that did happen at the time Horemheb began to rule. As I said right at the beginning, we don't know exactly when Horemheb's reign was. Other dates that I've given on this talk at the beginning are approximate, probably within 20 years either side of the correct date, but we'll never be able to pin that down. But if that was a time of when the heavens were back in order, that would very much have suited Horemheb's mission.